the Kingdom of Benin. The Dieng Museum respectfully acknowledges the Ramaytush Ohlone, the original people of what is now the San Francisco Peninsula, and acknowledges that the Greater Bay Area is the ancestral territory of the Miwoks, the Yokuts, and other Ohlone. Indigenous communities have lived and moved through this place over hundreds of generations, and indigenous people from many nations live and work in this region today. Please join us in acknowledging and honoring their communities, their elders past and present, as well as future generations. This program was made possible by the Friends of the Arts of Africa, Oceania, and the Americas, and many thanks also to Cynthia Inaba, the Docent Council, Lauren Ito, our finance department for their support. A special thank you to our speakers, Numbusi Enzolomba and Barbara Plankensteiner. I would also like to express my sincere thanks to Constantine Petridis for partnering with me to plan this program and for moderating the discussion. Dr. Petridis is the curator of African art and chair of the Department of the Arts of Africa and the Americas at the Art Institute of Chicago. Prior to his arrival in Chicago in 2016, Costa was the first full-time curator of African art at the Cleveland Museum of Art, organizing numerous exhibitions and accompanying publications, and I'll just name a few. South of the Sahara, Selected Works of African Art in 2003, Art and Power in the Central African Savannah in 2008, The Art of Daily Life, Portable Objects from Southeast Africa in 2011, and Fragments of the Invisible, the René and Odette Deligne Collection of Congo Sculpture in 2013. In 2015, he organized the exhibition Sunofu, Art and Identity in West Africa, which traveled to Montpellier, France. He has authored more than 45 essays in scholarly journals, collective volumes, and exhibition catalogs. Most recently, Dr. Petridis published Lulua, Central African Art Between Heaven and Earth, a monograph that's based on his PhD dissertation that he defended some 20 years ago at Ghent University in his native Belgium. Currently, Costa is working on a catalog of highlights of the African art collection at the Art Institute with essays from external scholars, and that's scheduled to be released in the fall of 2020. We were very pleased to host his exhibition, Art and Power, a number of years ago, and I'm very grateful for Costa's ongoing and many years of consultation concerning our developing collection of African art. So thank you so much for joining us, and Costa.
Good morning to all of you, and welcome to this institution, the Dieng Museum of Art. And thank you very much, Christina, for this generous introduction. Too long for somebody who's just going to be the moderator of a conversation. And by the way, when I finished my dissertation, I was really young, 20 years ago. But beyond that, it's my honor to be here, and so thanks again to the institution at large, its director Tom Campbell, but especially also the department and Christina's colleagues who've all contributed to make this day happen. It's my pleasure to briefly introduce you to the topic of today. I will be as brief as I can. After that, I will introduce our two distinguished panelists before each of them then takes the stage to give a brief 10-minute-long introductory remarks delineating their experience with a topic that interests us today and their particular viewpoints, after which I will engage in a dialogue with them, and then depending on how long our questions and answers are, there will be hopefully plenty of time for you, the audience, to contribute to the conversation and ask your questions or make your comments. So today's program is dedicated to a topic that has been occupying us for quite some time, and most recently since November 2018, a report that was released upon the request of the French President Emmanuel Macron, a report that was authored by two academics, Felvin Sarr and Bénédicte Savoy, and that made recommendations for the restitution of African cultural heritage to the source countries from which objects had been taken. As a result of that recommendation, a debate that actually had been opened many, many decades ago was reinvigorated, and the complex subjects of restitution and repatriation have garnered the interest and the attention of people from many different disciplines. And as a result of that, more colloquia and conferences on the topic have been held around the world, and many of us, Barbara, Duisi, and myself, and many of you, I'm sure, have been listening, following, and sometimes even participating in these debates. The opinions about the Sarr-Savoie report have been very varied, strong opposition on the one hand, applause and support on the others. The fact is that our discipline and our profession, the museum profession, has been affected by the report and by the conversations that have followed upon it or after. Today's conversation will focus on the case of the Benin bronzes, the so-called Benin bronzes, referring to these objects, and not only those made out of copper alloys, but also objects made out of ivory that are related to the glorious history of a kingdom in West Africa, the Kingdom of Benin, that have been admired for a long time, and ever since the first objects from the Benin Kingdom arrived in the West, they were exhibited and appraised by the general public, and they received a great deal of scholarly attention. But the appearance of these objects, to put it euphemistically, in Western collections, first in Europe, later in the United States, is all related to a military raid that happened in 1897 by British colonials, and that led to the export, the mass export of hundreds and probably rather thousands of objects to various institutions and later collections, to beginning with the British Museum. A group, an organization, was created in 2010 called the Benin Dialogue Group, and in October 2018 they released recommendations that in turn inspired the Sarr-Savoie report. It's important to remember that those recommendations appeared before the publication of the Sarr-Savoie report. And in the Benin Dialogue Group, about which we will hear more in a minute, led officials of the British Museum in London and other important European museums that housed, extensive collections of Benin art to loan and return important artifacts back to a new museum for art looted from the Benin Kingdom to be built in Benin City. Of course, in practice, this recommendation and the initiative has also, again, caused a lot of conversation and debate, and the few initiatives that have been undertaken to actually implement some of these recommendations have proven to be complicated and complex. And when transferred to the United States, there is the case of the Rhode Island School of Design's Art Museum that started in 2019 the process to return one single bronze head from their collection, and it stumbled on significant issues and hurdles with regard to tracing the provenance of the artifact in question and then ultimately executing the implementation of the actual repatriation of restitution. So in today's conversation, we will address the European side of the conversations, the Benin Dialogue Group's work, but also the relationship with the museum scene in the United States. We will touch on a variety of topics, and I will get back to those in a second, but let me first of all introduce our first presenter of today to you. So it's my great pleasure and honor to welcome Duisi Ezelwomba, our relatively new colleague of African art as an African art curator from the New Orleans Museum of Art, where he holds the title of Françoise Billion Richardson Curator of African Art. It's a position that he took up in August 2018. After having served for about 2 years as a Mellon Foundation-supported curatorial research specialist in African art at the Virginia Museum of Fine Arts in Richmond. Andy, as he's known by his friends and colleagues, is first a painter and a sculptor. He holds undergraduate degrees in fine and applied arts from the University of Benin, which he obtained in 2000, a graduate degree in African Studies from the University of Ibadan in 2003. And important for our conversation is that he grew up in Benin City, where he lived for about 30 years, but he is of Igbo heritage, and he was born in Ibadan in Yoruba country, very cosmopolitan, as you can tell. After a short break, that led him to the United Kingdom and partly also Wales. He moved to the United States and in 2017 obtained a PhD in art history at the University of Florida, Gainesville, under Professor Poyner. His doctoral dissertation focuses on the function of shrines dedicated to Olokun, the central deity in the religious pantheon of Benin, in the culture of the Edo-speaking people of southern Nigeria. His bibliography is ever expanding. His articles pertain to Benin and his doctoral research and other historical arts of Africa, but also modern and contemporary art, African art. He's also interested in the subjects of repatriation and cultural property, as it is reflected in an essay that is forthcoming in a volume entitled Museum Innovation, and he will share some of his thoughts with us today. He will present in English, but it's interesting to know that his many languages include Igbo, Yoruba, Edo, Hausa, and also a little bit of Welsh. But thank you, Andy, to join us and to give us your presentation of the matter.
Thank you, Costa. That was a very lengthy one. Good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
Like Costa rightly said, my name is, folks call me Andy, but my name is Ndubisi Ezelumba. It is good to be here this morning. That is the title of my paper. Yes. I will not forget to point to the historical incident that resulted to the looting of Benin art, which is the subject of our gathering this morning. Even though it's never my intention to pursue that historical trajectory, I am compelled to make in commentary about it to help create a sharper focus on the material. By providing this account of the history of that event, we are able to glean a clearer picture of the idea embedded within my discussion as we go along. That is the map of Benin. The British government, acting upon request from the Royal Niger Company to remove the Benin king, who was seen as an obstacle to trade, happened around about this time, 1897, a British force of about 1,200 men, supported by several hundred African auxiliaries, besieged Benin City. The raid, I know that in the literature some of them want to refer to it as a punitive expedition, but the raid, as the colonial forces they used to call them, bombarded the city of Benin for 3 days from a port, a seaport called Ugotun. They touched the city and looted 500 years worth of bronze or brass, ivory, and different other kinds of objects, as you can see on that slide there. These were national treasures that constituted the royal archives of Benin history. The Oba, who was in place at that time, Oba Ovonrawen, was deposed and sent to die in exile. And the Benin Kingdom was incorporated into the nation of Nigeria, around about 1914. During its glorious period, from the 13th to the 19th century, it produced one of the continent's most sophisticated artistic legacies, as you can see. To reflect the splendor of the royal court, the order commissioned highly skilled artisans to create rare and beautiful works of cast brass and carved ivories. This included human and animal forms. It also includes relief plaques, elephant tusks, pendants, brasses, life-size commemorative heads of others and queen mothers, and ceremonial objects to adorn the royal palace and the altars honoring the Obas of the past. The exquisite brass heads were intended to function as objects celebrating ancestors and also as war trophies and as focal points of sacrificial ceremonies, like you can see from that shrine. Characteristically, Benin art was created for the Oba and his elaborate court. The art is a court art, dedicated to the service of the Oba and the complex rituals that complement his status in the society. Even though the art can be looked as religious art, it was mostly a royal one because of the material used in its creation. In the past, brass and ivory was the exclusive reserve of the Oba, and he determined who could have access to art objects created using such material. Due to these characteristics, it was not surprising when an Africanist, Nabadomski Joseph, declares that the technical virtuosity and artistic excellence of Benin art astonished then puzzled European curators. This is because the artist placed much attention to create an object that measured up to the expectations of the Oba. I throw that slide there as a picture of what modern Benin Guild of Brass Casters Quarter looked like. Over to what we have here today. Fairly recently we have come across all those topics that you see up there. The conversations about the repatriation of looted Benin art have been ongoing. It is pertinent to state that all claims to the conversation presents valid explanation to support their sides of the debate. Two shades of opinion that is rife are those who demand the total and immediate return of the materials, and another that advocate that this object not be returned at all. I share opinion partly from both sides. My opinion captures the yearning of both calls and arguments. It is expedient to return this object, especially since they were looted, stolen from Benin in 1897. By their return, over a century-old injustice will be rectified. However, there are many practical concerns about the well-being of the material for when they return to Benin. I may begin to sound a little bit off cuff here. I think why I tried upon this logic for the not immediate return of the object is that I think that it's only rational to take such a route. As much as we, even me, want to find justification for the delayed return, it is important to consider the well-being of the material for when they return. In articulating my idea of repatriation with sense, I look at the various shades of argument and deduce my perception about the need to negotiate for a favorable way that cater to the wellness of the object. It is not my intent to explicate upon this right this minute, although further discussion will explain that point more clearly. Similarly, I look at the complexities in navigating the return of the object to modern day Nigeria, especially looking at the case of the ROISD. One cannot but help worry about the practicalities of returning this object. Would we be returning the object to Nigeria, an entity created out of colonization and only came into existence in the early part of the 20th century? Also, if the object bypasses the political bureaucracy of Nigeria State and go directly to Benin, is that a valid route to go? We can continue with various other questions in that regard. Some of the arguments for the return of the object have tended to demonstrate the impossibility of persons from Benin or from maybe Africa, like scholars and students, going to see the objects maybe where they're kept in the different country or different places. And the argument continues that it is very difficult for these scholars to, you know, find the possibility to get to this object for different kinds of study. That claim is very valid. But also, there is a nearby claim to that, and that is, like I was stating earlier on, these objects were royal objects made specifically for the king. And it was only the king that had access, and he was the only one that enjoyed it. And so if we bring back the objects and we return them back to their original context, it leaves me with a big wonder how many of my likes will have access to this material. I can continue to, you know, speak about how I feel about the repatriation of this material. But I think it will be more expedient for us to sit over in that round table and then kind of talk a little bit more about how we feel deeply about the material. Thank you.
Thank you, Andy Dubisi. I think I'm going to learn how to pronounce your name correctly instead of this. Next, we will hear from a European colleague, Barbara Plankensteiner, who is currently the director of the Museum am Rothenbaum, Kulturen und Künste der Welt, World Cultures and Arts, in Hamburg, Germany. A museum that was established in 1879, but was drastically restructured and renamed under Barbara's leadership in 2017, which is the year that she took office in April, specifically in that museum. Before starting in Hamburg, she was, for about 2 years, the Francis and Benjamin Benenson Curator, Senior Curator, Foundation Senior Curator of African Art at the Yale University Art Gallery. And before that, she held various titles from 1998 to when she moved to Yale at the museum that is currently called the Weltkulturmuseum, the World Museum in World Culture Museum in Vienna. Barbara has a PhD in social and cultural anthropology, which she earned from Vienna University in 2002. She also graduated from the Getty Museum Leadership Institute in 2012. She's been actively involved for a long time in many collaborative European museum projects, and actually last year she edited the book The Art of Being a World Culture Museum, Future and Lifeways of Ethnographic Museums in Contemporary Europe. But of course, one of the main reasons why we brought her to San Francisco today is her long-standing involvement with art from Benin. She curated a very important traveling exhibition in 2007 titled Benin, Kings and Rituals, Court Arts from Nigeria, that actually traveled to the Art Institute of Chicago in 2008. It was its only US venue. In 2010, she authored a monograph on Benin art in the Visions of Africa series for Five Continents editions. And of course, and most significantly, she was a co-founder of the Benin Dialogue Group. She organized the group's first meeting, which happened in Vienna in 2010. And currently, she's co-chair, together with Prince Gregory Akenzwa, of the steering committee of the Benin Dialogue Group. She's been interested in questions of heritage and the topic of decolonization of museums, and that also is reflected in an article about the Benin treasures in a collective volume titled Cultural Property and Contested Ownership. And along the same lines, on September 26, 2017, she hosted a conference entitled Shared Heritage, Colonial Knowledge in History and the Present, at the Hamburg Museum. So we're very honored to have Barbara join us in the conversation today, and I welcome you to make your opening statements. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Kostya, for your kind words of introduction. Thank you very much, Christina and the De Young Museum, for inviting me to come to San Francisco. And for me, it's very interesting. I have not been to the US for a couple of years, and it's very interesting to hear how this discussion about colonial heritage is taking ground also here in the United States. In Europe, it is a very important subject, and particularly in Germany. And as a context for our conversation today, I would like to introduce and speak a little bit about this context in Germany that really very much shapes our work in museums, particularly museums with an ethnographic tradition. Costa has just spoken about my museum. It is one of the old ethnographic museums in Europe, maybe let's say the second largest ethnographic collection in Germany. And the report of Felvin Sarr and Benedikt Savoy has already been mentioned in 2000. That was published in 2018, and in 2017, it was preceded by this famous talk of Emmanuel Macron in Burkina Faso in November 2017, in which he promised to bring back in the next 5 years African art to the continent on a permanent and on a temporary basis, and then appointed Felvin Sarr and Benedikt Savoy to issue this report. But significantly before that happened in 2007, there was sort of a blast in Germany when Benedikt Savoy, who is a professor of art history at the Technical University in Berlin and was a member of the advisory board of one of the big cultural projects in Europe, the Humboldt, the soon to be opened Humboldt Forum in Berlin, that will be the largest museum of its kind, housing the prominent ethnographic collections of the Ethnological Museum in Berlin. And she was a member of the advisory board and stepped down from that position by giving an interview in a very prominent German newspaper, saying the reason why she did that because the institution did not address the blot sticking on these works that were going to be exhibited, addressing the fact that the provenance history and the history of their appropriation in the colonial context was not, to her opinion, mentioned in the permanent display. So I also show here caricature, I don't know how to say that in English, in showing something that is constantly happening and shows a lot of how there is much discussion in the public opinion about Benin, but it's constantly confused because Macron was promising, and that is going to happen obviously very soon, that 26 works from Dahomey, the now Republic of Benin, the royal treasure of the Dahomey Kingdom, will be returned as a first step, and it's constantly confused with the Benin Kingdom we are speaking about here, that is located in southern Nigeria. In Germany, after all these incidents, there was a lot of public discussion also very much promoted by the diverse society we're living in. Many activists, people of color, who requested that public institutions and politicians should address colonial history. And this, in fact, had a large impact even in the coalition contract of the now government in Germany in 2018. There is a section mentioned that Germany wants to address colonial history and colonial legacies, and they want to invest in collaboration, particularly collaboration with museums in Africa, and to invest in cultural institutions in Africa. And the foreign ministry in Germany is establishing at the moment, and it's soon to be, it's about to be founded, an agency for museum collaboration, for instance. And also, the foreign ministry finances public discussions and conferences about the subject. And the first of these conferences took place at my museum and was organized by us together with the German Goethe Institute, which is the cultural institute, foreign cultural institute, like the Centre Culturel Français, but for Germany. And it was the first time that in Germany there was a conference in which African museum colleagues and scholars were invited to discuss with German politicians, with German museum people, and with activists about the future of colonial collections. And a second conference, financed by the Foreign Ministry, will take place now in March in Tanzania, which will be organized completely from the perspective of African colleagues. And the results of our conversations in this conference in Hamburg flow into political decision making. At the same time, the German Museum Association issued guidelines for the care of collections from colonial contexts, which for all the museums in Germany is sort of a handbook to how to deal with these collections, about what the defining context is for so-called colonial a colonial context, and which steps museums should take to address this. And particularly, so the main points in these guidelines are is provenance research, collaboration with colleagues in the originating societies to address these issues, and a sensibility for the expectations of partners in these originating societies. So a first edition has been published in 2018 in spring, and then a number of experts, 12 experts from all over the world, particularly from the Americas, Oceania, and Africa, have been invited to comment on this first edition, and their inputs flew into a second edition that is online, also in English, and can be viewed online. At the moment, they are still taking in further inputs by people who want to comment, and a final edition will be issued soon. Something that happened this year was Germany is a federal state, and each federal state has cultural ministers, and so there is sort of a meeting, a conference of these cultural ministers. They edited first focal points this spring to address collections from colonial contexts that are also supported by the State Minister of the Republic for Culture and Media. And I just quote here one extract from those focal points, which in a way are we need to follow as public institutions. And in this, I just quote in this paper, it is mentioned that in close exchange with originating states and affected descendant communities, we take the responsibility for cultural goods from colonial contexts seriously. We aim to create foundations for the return of human remains and for the return of cultural goods that had been appropriated under circumstances that we today deem legally or ethically not appropriate. Together with the respective institutions, we will treat return processes with the necessary expedience and sensibility. And in the wake of this public announcement, also an office has been created in a large cultural foundation, Kulturstiftung der Länder, in Berlin, an office that is particularly geared to be a point of access for all collections in Germany, where people from all over the world and institution can ask for information where which collections are located, and they will assemble that information and will be a major point to get information from as a nodal point. There have been also restitutions done from Germany this year, and maybe the most prominent one was to return the Bible and the Witboy Bible and a whip from his former possession to Namibia. This has caused a lot of discussions in Namibia and also in the public in Germany, because it was returned to the nation state of Namibia, and it was criticized by the Nama and Herero people that it did not go directly to the community. Another return has been done to Alaska from the Stiftung Preußischer Kultur besitz of objects that have been appropriated in the colonial period from graves located there. Yes, this all happens also in another much debated instance at the moment, which is a proposal for a new definition of a museum definition issued by ICOM. This has been very much debated in Tokyo this year, and this new definition already shows a shift in how museums themselves perceive them, or would like to perceive themselves, and to understand themselves much more, not just to house and preserve collections, but also as very important institution for our society, as democratizing inclusive and polyphonic spaces that should be open for critical dialogue about past and future, addressing also conflicts and challenges of the present, and that they hold artifacts in trust for society, but also safeguarding diverse memories for future generations and guarantee equal rights and equal access to this heritage for all people. And so they need to be participatory and transparent and work in active partnership with diverse communities to collect, preserve, and so forth these collections. They should contribute to human dignity and social justice, global equality, and planetary well-being. And this is also very much in discussion in our museum field. And at the moment, Costa has already mentioned our European projects in which over 10 ethnographic museums, we are now 12 in a future project that has the title Taking Care and addresses these issues for museums of ethnographic traditions, in which we kind of create a community to discuss the future of our institutions. But now I come to the Benin Dialogue, and I wanted to introduce this larger context, because this all also affects the Benin Dialogue that has been created in 2010 after this big Benin exhibition that was shown in Vienna, in Paris, at the Quiberon Lee, at the Berlin Ethnological Museum, and at the Art Institute in Chicago, but it has not been shown in Nigeria. And we felt it was kind of awkward, and we, after this exhibition, together in conversation with Nigerian museum colleagues, we thought we need to do something about this, and we have to change this, and we have to address this difficult heritage that is a legacy that is difficult for us museums that host these important collections and for our Nigerian colleagues and institutions there. And we started this group as an informal group in which we involved museum colleagues from the large European museums that hold large collections of Benin art. This group has grown significantly and now is kind of getting better organized. We have a steering committee, we meet every year, and the goal is to bring back a significant number of important Benin works to Benin City, and it's a constant discussion in progress. There has been mentioned that at some point, and I have to say, we started out with the idea to bring back permanent loans, because that, at the moment when we founded this group in 2010, was the only way that we could envision to bring works back to Benin City without having to involve a legal level and also politicians. It would have been something that we could have done on our museum level. That's how it started. But in the meanwhile, the discussion has progressed, and it will be, from some museums, objects will be returned as permanent loans, but from other, they might be permanently returned, and there are also already conversations going on, because each museum has a different stakeholders, a different legal circumstances, but so this whole idea is progressing and changing considerably every year. So we meet every year. Our last meeting was in Benin City in July in 2019, where the first plans for a future Royal Museum have been presented, and the very famous architect David Ajaya has been appointed to elaborate a vision for this museum. There is already a group in place, somebody in charge to raise funds to create this museum, and so we very much hope when we next meet in September at the British Museum that there will be more concrete plans to bring this project forward, which I think is very important to make this all happen. Yes, just coming back to my museum in Hamburg, we also have a very significant collection of Benin works that is not very much known, because my museum, out of financial restraints, did not have a curator for the Africa collection for over 25 years. And since I'm there, I'm looking more deeply into that collection. And it's a very interesting collection because it has objects that are not maybe so prominent and important from an art perspective, but they tell a lot about the history of the kingdom and of its relationships. And it has some really unique works. And Hamburg is a very important site for the history of Benin works in Europe, because it's not much known that most of the collection on the continent in Europe, in Germany and Austria and also other places, did not come to Europe through British members of this military raid, but actually they came to Europe afterwards through trade agents, Hamburg trade agents. So it came through the Hamburg port. That's why in Hamburg we have quite significant collections, of which we don't know exactly the provenance, and we are starting now a provenance research project, because in our collection these are just associated with names, and we assume that these people have been working for trading or shipping companies and brought back these things when this whole story became so famous in Germany. And what we also found in our collection, we have historic photographs that predate other photographs that are known, and that already show, that give a different insight in the local setting. But also coming back to the ICOM definition and all the discourse that's going on, so we are establishing our museum, for instance, very much as a place of encounter and discussion in which we have debates on colonial heritage, on subjects as restitution that really draws a large public, particularly the diverse multicultural public from Hamburg, but also many, many young people and many young scholars for whom this is a very necessary and important discussion. We also have several projects of collaboration, for instance, also with other regions. We have, for instance, fellowships that are particularly geared to work with our collections, and we are in fall, we will open an exhibition on the colonial history and a specific chapter of that history that connects Hamburg with Douala, the port city in Cameroon, and it will be an exhibition particularly for young people and families, in which we will show our Douala collection, but we work together with descendants of famous trading dynasty in Douala, the Bell family, of which one of the most important members, who is in the memory of Cameroon people, he is comparable to Lumumba in the Congo as a resistance, somebody who resisted German colonial empire, and we work together with people and scholars there tell more about this history. And this is just one of the many projects that we try to do in collaboration, in which we contextualize on our collections in a different way as it has been done in the past. Thank you very much.
So I invite our guests to take a seat, and I'll give you some water so that while you get settled, you drink a bit if you want. And so what I thought of doing is I'll ask a few questions to each of them, and we'll focus to begin with on the Benin case. But we will slowly, I think, move on to the broader question, and then hopefully we'll have some time to hear from you in the audience. So yeah, maybe I'd start with Andy, a simple question. You alluded to it earlier, but just to give us very briefly a sense of what it is to be in Benin City today, what the population of the city thinks, A, about royal art, the kingdom, how much access they have to the kingdom as such. Again, you alluded to it earlier, but more significantly, what is the general feeling or commentary on this whole debate that has been going on for some time now in the United States and Europe?
Very sophisticated. To an expert of the.
I may not be very good statistically to, you know, begin to call numbers when it comes to the size of Benin City today, but you know, like many cities in the nation Nigeria, Benin is a thriving city, growing. I want to say from strength to strength. I think I use that. I look to that because being raised in Benin City, kind of, you know, studying the growth for over 30 years while I was growing there indicates to me the size is actually expanding. But you know, take away from the actual geographical space and the size of the humans that live within that space, I think I'll quickly run to what we are dealing with today, which is this whole thing about repatriation. Just like it is in my paper, where I say there are obviously strands of opinion out there. A great number are in support of this material to come back, no doubt. I also stand with that number. But there are other numbers I'm sure either suffering from the aftermath of, you know, colonialism, or even the more neo-colonialism, where, you know, Christianity kind of distort the opinion of a lot. Quite a number of growing citizens of Benin also does not think that it is even necessary to, you know, consider the material that we are dealing with here. But that does not mean that we cannot consider these little voices, or, you know, these voices of this other sect that, you know, don't see anything, you know, wonderful in this material. But I think what stands out to me is this whole consciousness that the royal institution, which obviously is the most significant body in Benin thought, as a matter of fact, the royal institution are aware, and they, I think, in a press release that came with a catalog sometime, I think the catalog that accompanied Barbara's show to Paris, there was a press release by the Oba before the new one, where he actually requested that this object should come back to Benin, because the object, according to that statement, holds a significant history of the people. So if we look at it from that perspective, yes, quite there is a huge cry for it to come back. And scholars, researchers, and even students potentially will, you know, kind of gain access to this material, going by another layer of, you know, argument out there, because as the study of artistry begin to grow and flourish in Nigerian universities, there is always the need, there is obviously going to be the need for them to have access to the material. But I think looking forward, or you know, looking at what we are trying to achieve from externally, I think as the consciousness has been planted, as we go along, and then we realize most of what we are agitating for, which is obviously bringing the object back, I know that at that point, it will come to a win-win situation. I'm sure I'm going to speak more on this later, but you know, tie that back to what Barbara was describing just now. If after a space of time we achieve repatriation in a very well negotiated way, I think all parties involved will feel satisfied.
Thank you. To Barbara then, to the point that Andy was describing, after your big traveling exhibition, were there effectively claims that had been made by the Oba or his court directed to the exhibition's contents? And if so, what was the response at the time? Or indirectly, what happened in the period between 2007 and then ultimately 2018?
In 2007, and after the exhibition, there have been no, I mean, there has been no official claim, but the Oba, as Andy mentioned in the introduction to the catalog, writes that he would wish and ask if that some works should be returned. And so there has been discussion in the media, but there was no official claim. But we sometimes forget how much perception of these things have changed in the last, let's say, 10 years. And also when we started the Benin Dialogue, it was clear that, you know, there was always talk about the legal framework. There was no legal framework that would allow Nigeria to claim it back, because all the convention, the UNESCO conventions, they are not retroactive, and so there would not have been a legal framework. That's why when we started, we wanted to go about with permanent loans, because that would have been the easiest way forward, and it was the common agreement. In the meanwhile, this has changed significantly, and I think there are in several, I mean, there is a general perception that it should happen on moral grounds, and there is much more understanding for this also from the political side, which in 2007 was actually not the case. And so this whole discussion has really changed the mindset of many people. And I think also there's a new generation of museum curators, a new generation of museum directors, and a new perception in the society, and particularly in Europe. You know, we our societies, they are, I mean, they are very diverse. And it is, I think, to address colonial history is relevant so that we can live together on a different basis in Europe. That's why it happens.
In the United States, at least, we've referred to it too earlier, like the Rhode Island School of Design, that was a voluntary proposition to return one object to Nigeria. So I was wondering, as a rule, a claim is not necessary to undertake the process of repatriation or restitution. But why do you know of any case where that has actually happened successfully with regard to Benin, the voluntary restitution? And if not, like for the case of Rhode Island School, the only thing we know is what appeared in the press, and they just point out the complexities, but they don't go into the details. So I'm just trying to understand what is it that you know, prevents these efforts, especially if they're made on a voluntary basis by private institutions, which I think we should acknowledge are different private museums in the United States from federal or state funded and run institutions in Europe. So what are the complications, the hurdles that have prevented this to happen?
I think it is known that there was a return by a private individual, a descendant of a former member of this military expedition, Herbert Walker, returned two items, I think, directly to the Oba. I don't know about what the complications are in this Rhode Island case, but I think a lot of people, I mean, there are some conversation happening in the background, and there have been offers to return, which are still in discussion. But so the official, there is an official way how to deal with it for Nigeria, because in Nigeria there is the federal entity that is responsible for cultural heritage in the country, is the National Commission for Museums and Monuments, and that is part of the cultural ministry in Nigeria. So by law in Nigeria, this institution is responsible for cultural heritage, so every return would have to go directly through this entity, and they then would further disseminate, etc. And so in the Benin Dialogue, there are the National Commission is involved, there's a representative of the Royal Court, and since 2018 also a representative of the Edo government, because the actual governor of Edo State is very, very supporting this whole idea and made it as his personal agenda. And he is very much behind this whole idea to really bring this project of the Foreign Museum forward. And I think at the moment, certainly, it might be also this Benin Dialogue that, you know, people are waiting what is happening, because we have to consider that this is one of the major, you know, corpuses of art from Africa. And so it's political decisions that have to be taken, particularly if it's public-owned collections. And I think this idea of the museum is very helpful in this regard. But so there's a lot of just waiting when it will happen and when this formal institution is officially founded. And I think then more things will happen, because also we have to consider this whole question of restitution. It involves many, many, many practical and steps to prepare it from our side, from institutions that might want to return, the whole documentation, research that has to flow into it, the paperwork you have to do to bring about a decision that then is a political decision. And on the other side, also, for instance, in Nigeria, also the institutions have to get prepared, you know, to welcome these things back, because we all want to be that is a success and not a failure.
Yeah, I don't know if I'm going to add anything really very significant to what Barbara said, but I think you know, the case of the individual that returned objects to the Oba of Benin, I want to assume that, you know, that could happen on a case-by-case basis. But, you know, a much more bigger case as this whole, if we are dealing with this whole big catch of, you know, Benin material, I don't know that we just need to wake up overnight and, you know, return those things. It has to go through a process, but I know that, you know, we are certain that, you know, when the process kicks off, we will be able to, you know, kind of figure out how to, you know, get these things out. Yes.
So it leads me to the question about museums in Africa, which is a comment that is often made by objectors to the whole restitution and repatriation idea and initiative, where people deplore the status of museums on the African continent and basically argue that, especially people not living on the African continent, that museums are unsafe, that they're vulnerable to theft, and that alone is a reason to object to restitutions. Of course, when one hears of a brand new museum that needs to be built in Benin City to welcome these treasures back from Europe, one could easily deduce that there's a confirmation implied of this deplorable state of museums in Africa, whereas in Benin City itself, there is a museum already there, which is part of that broader network of national museums and monuments. So maybe for Andy, who assumingly has traveled not only in Nigeria and seen other museums of the same network, but also beyond, what is your thought about this often heard comment against restitution in view of the fact that museums wouldn't be ready to receive objects from the West?
Thank you. That argument, it gets to the point where it becomes very irrelevant, because I feel that, you know, the whole idea of, you know, museum were actually Western construct being trying to come into Africa. That does not mean that, you know, Africa didn't have ways of displaying this material. before they were looted, especially Benin. We knew that those objects were not removed from storage when they were taken, and they were actually displayed in the palace of the king. There are other avenues, I believe, and I think I started working on a very small idea that I titled shrines as mini museums. These are all different kinds of ways that objects were displayed. But I think since a lot of African nations are kind of catching into this idea of museums, it only becomes appropriate that this material are returning back to where they can really be comfortable. We don't want to return them and subject them to certain kind of conditions that may lead to their eventual maybe destruction, maybe pillaging, or something of that sort. So I think that in our bid if we spend all this time thinking about how people will react about this thing of not having museum or this or that, I think that is actually somewhat significant, not 100%, but I think the more important thing to deal with here still falls back to that my idea of well negotiated out repatriation, whereby in the course of negotiation we are able to get those things we need on ground for when those objects comes back. The case of Benin is very, very significant to use as case in point. With the creation of the Royal Museum, it comes with layers and layers and layers of positives, because we know that the way I was describing Benin Oba, the Benin Oba is this human being that is looked upon as a spirit, even though he's in the midst of men, and an ordinary Benin person fears what comes out from the mouth of the king. So whereby the National Museum of Monument structures that are out there filled with some kind of workers that are most of the time maybe administrative or some other kind of roles, the way they probably manage or handle material that they have with them there is questionable, left alone when we bring all these materials back. But appending that thing royal or oba, oba, it comes with another layer of security that obviously most of these objects need for when they come back. I think these kinds of negotiations put in place and then bringing the object back makes sense.
I maybe would like to add something which is also not so commonly known, but I would say that many museums in Europe also don't have perfect conditions. We are not these grand institutions like here, and I have sent many places, and I have to say many of the museums, or also in Germany, are underfinanced and would not live up to expectations of how a museum should store and care for the objects.
It's an interesting and important point, but it also leads to another question, and this will be the last one that I will take from you, and then we can open it up to general discussion. But one thing that we might want to come back to is 1897 as a date, which is often presented as like the cutoff date and the date by which decisions have to be made, and I've come to learn that that's not as clear and straightforward either. But anyway, my real question was, especially with reference to something like the NAGPRA, the Native American Grave and Repatriation Act that is in place here in the United States when it comes to human remains and objects from Native American tribes, there is the reference is often made in Africa, and the comment is then made, why are we talking about returning objects to museums? Shouldn't they go back to the communities, the ethnic groups, the cultures, where they originated, and where these objects may still have a role to play So shouldn't the restitution repatriation debate not be focused on this more local, community-based level than the national level? And I'm just curious to hear your respective comments, both as a museum professional and then who's involved in these discussions and as somebody who is from the culture about which, or one of the cultures about which some of this conversation happens.
Thank you. I think the NAGPRA thing is really very detailed, and I think some African cultures actually have similarities with things like for instance NAGPRA, but you know. I'm not looking only to Benin now. If we look at some of the objects that we are talking about, especially those removed within ritual context and have stored up until this time, one of my very salient argument will be that in those cultures when objects were created and used within ritual context, they actually have a life. And when they reach that, their ritual life, they are actually laid to rest and to kind of disintegrate and go away. Having been removed from the context for where those materials were used, will they be coming back to that same ritual that they were used initially? Or will they be brought and kept in a store where they are going to be called to be used upon next time? But I doubt if that is going to be the case. I think that is a bit different than what we are dealing with in the case of Benin, where this material actually very, very tangible material that are not easily destructive. So you know, when most of these materials are coming back, are they coming back to the original context? Probably. Probably not. Probably they are. Benin, for instance, these bronzes, this brass and the ivories could actually return back and still be what they originally were removed. But I doubt that if that permeates with every other culture that produced things that were not made using materials like the type that we're dealing with among the Benin people.
Yeah, I think it's a relevant question, and it is. Can be dealt with differently if you are a public institution or if you're a private institution. So if I may speak for Germany, for instance, my museum is a museum of the city-state of Hamburg. So the collections are publicly owned, and we can make recommendations to the parliament, and they would have to decide if something should be returned or not. But in the end, if then a restitution should take place, it is a matter of foreign affairs, which is a national agenda. And so Germany as a national state, as a republic, needs to be involved. And so relationships between nations, they're between nations and not between nation and the community. So it depends with whom and which country you're interacting in this respect, and you cannot overrule local legislation. So, for instance, Nigeria, there is the legislation that the official entity you have to address in such question is the National Commission for Museums and Monuments. You cannot overrule that legislation and deal directly with the community. I mean, that's also, you know, it's impossible. And so that could cause conflict, maybe. We will have to see if things are happening. But so the procedure would be a procedure between nation state to start with, unless there is a different legislation that allows direct interaction and contact you can have, but if a return happens. And so that's a different case altogether with the United States and NAGPRA, because that's within nation states and there's a clear legislation and you don't have to, it's not a transnational interaction.
Okay, we have about 20, 15 to 20 minutes left for questions, comments. I don't know if there's mics. If not, I'll come close. I'll listen to your question. I'll repeat it in the mic, and hopefully our speakers can then answer.
Thank you. My question is about the British holdings of Benin art. My understanding is that the British Museum is one of the largest holders of Benin objects. Are they involved at all in any of these wonderful initiatives that are going on in Europe?
Yes, the British Museum has been involved from the beginning on, so it was part of the Benin Dialogue since 2010. And actually, they are organizing the next meeting, and so they're very much involved. One thing that is particular about the British Museum is they have this legislation of the inalienability of their collection. So what they are going to contribute is on a permanent loan basis as of now. I mean, we don't know if legislation might change in Britain as well, but for now that's the framework in which they are acting. And for instance, they are giving now also permanent loan to another museum that has been founded in Lagos, the J.K. Randall Museum of Yoruba Art and Heritage, I think it's called. And so the British Museum will provide works for that new museum on a permanent loan basis.
And maybe just to clarify, when you say permanent loan, you mean long-term loans? Because here it could cause some confusion between a loan is temporary and a return would be permanent. So it's a long-term loan that may be without any end even. So, other questions?
Thank you. My question was the same. Thank you very much for asking.
That's easy. Thank you.
Okay. Anyone else? I'm sure there must be questions or even comments, not a question. Yes. I'll start with the gentleman behind you.
Good morning. I'm Anthony Meyer. I'm a dealer in tribal art, and as such, in a very unofficial manner, I represent the tribal art trade with which African art, of course, is a major component. In Europe, we have a tremendous hue and cry with the report that was published by Saint Savoy, and it has caused very, very extensive discussion. Europe-wide, the paradox is that it in France turned out to be simply a report and not a permanent suggestion of situation, and the French government has decided to not take into account the information or the suggestions that were put forth in most cases in the report. I'd just like to get back to the Benin situation. If my memory is correct, as a young dealer in the 80s, I already remember that Benin was requesting the return of certain pieces that were being offered at auction in Christie's and Sotheby's in London at that time. So this is not a new situation. The other thing that I'd like to point out, relating specifically to Benin art, but within the context of the Saint Savoy report, is that the word restitution is a very, very dangerous word. Repatriation, return, sharing, all of those things are totally understandable, totally wanted by, I would say, 99% of the population. But the notion of restitution infers a criminal situation. With Benin, I must admit that I'm not versed enough in the situation to be able to make a firm commitment in one direction or another. However, I would like to remind all of us that the arrival of the Benin art in the Western world, in Europe, in 1897, is basically one of the causes of the awakening of European culture to the magnificence and the aesthetic and world heritage importance of African art in general within the context of art history. Von Luschamp, German anthropologist, museum curator, wrote a fantastic text about the quality of Benin art, comparing it to the bronze work of the Renaissance, and that even the Europeans could not equal the aesthetics and the remarkable capacity for artistic achievement that the Benin artists had created. Without the arrival of the Benin art and without the arrival of all the other arts from all the other places in the world, the Western world, and in general the world at large, would not have all the artistic movements that have been created within the last 100 years. Cubism, Expressionism, Surrealism, all of these artworks, all of these art movements stem from a sharing. Now, of course, plundering, punitive expeditions, it's not actually an idea of sharing the way we would look at it. However, the end result is quite a marvelous situation, and without the, allow me to use a strange word, without the extraction of the art from the original source cultures and the reappropriation or appropriation of the art by the artists of the world, we would not be sitting here today having this discussion. Thank you.
Yeah, no doubt. Everything you have just commented upon is, you know, truly stand out. We are not going to deny that fact. But I feel that, you know, I feel that rightly, if this material goes back to whoever they belong to, it now left them to, you know, decide whatever condition they want to participate in, either to share or to, you know, trade off or things like that. So I believe strongly that for instance, this Benin material that we speak about, when in 2007, when, you know, Barbara did a show, the catalog indicated that, you know, the Renin Oba contributed works that they exhibited. So that is, you know, like an indication that, you know, if we shame and kill that episode that, you know, resulted to this raid and stealing of this material, I'm sure it will still be there for, you know, humankind to enjoy. But no, it's not like you holding it and continuously not want to give it back, and then you are making all these things up, you know.
Yes, I certainly also agree with what you are saying. I think it's this understanding of this very important chapter of African art is very significant worldwide. And I think this is a fact that nobody denies, and also our Nigerian colleagues and stakeholders we are working together with definitely agree, and everybody understands the value and importance that these works are out there in the world to communicate this prominent treasure of art, which is very significant for the continent. But there is an imbalance there, and I think we have to redress that. So I think one does not prohibit the other.
Thank you.
Costa, thank you. Yeah, I'm going to push back a bit, actually. There's no question that the removal of the Benin bronzes helped stimulate understanding of African art and culture in Europe. But if you follow the argument that that somehow justifies it, you're just justifying the strong taking from the weak. The reality is that the punitive raid was a put-up job. The murder of a couple of emissaries was taken as an excuse for an extremely punitive raid that killed thousands of people and that allowed the Europeans, the British, to plunder to a very considerable degree. It was premeditated, by the accounts I've read, and ethically and morally was reprehensible. It was just one of many such episodes during the colonial era, and thank God we don't live in such times today. So we have to, you know, we have to be able to now respond to this situation in light of moral ethics and behaviors. And, you know, just as the international museum community has taken an extremely strong stand about the return of works of art that were stolen from Jews during the Second World War by the Nazis, you know, I think we're, you know, conceivably, you can't right every wrong, but when you have an episode as discreet and clear as the stealing of the Bainan bronzes, the international community can sit on their hands and they can say, this is history, you know, difficult to know what to do about it. Or one can take an ethical position, which is what I think that the Bainan study group is moving towards. But I think that it does call for a proactive behavior, because you can't just whitewash activities like this.
Well, I have a logistical question. I'm Elaine, I'm a PhD student working on Congo arts. And in my travels around the US, I found that there are many smaller museums that have like a Benin plaque or a Benin head. And curators or directors are anxious. They know that the moral question is obvious, but there's an issue of If you're a small museum, if each individual museum wants to work with returning objects, that could be a headache for Benin. And is that something that the Benin Dialogue Group is thinking about, or are there consortia being put together for the smaller collections?
There'll be one more question after this for sure, but let's start with this one.
Yes, that is a subject that we are discussing also, because we try to keep the group not to a number where we can really work, because everything takes really long, because it's such a diplomatic endeavor. And it took us quite a while to get to the points where we are getting at, because there are so many different institutions involved. That's why we also kept it to European museums for now, because they are public institutions. It's a different story altogether. And, you know, so what we are now aiming at, because we get many people or small institutions that have some very small holdings are writing us, and they want to join the endeavor and they want to contribute. So we are just an informal group, you know, we do this on the side. This is not an institution with staff, etc. So it's all basically voluntary work what you do in addition to our jobs. And so what we will try to do to keep a channel of information open so that we can inform all institutions that would like to follow and contribute with information where we are heading to, and to try to, you know, to be a sort of channeling these interests, because I think, as you clearly say, institutions locally will be overwhelmed, and this is something that might affect Congolese, or because all these works are all over, and it can be quite a drain. I mean, if you're a community and then you are addressed by 10 major museums and you don't, you know, how are you dealing with it? Just bureaucratically and everything. So that's something that we need to find a solution for, and we are discussing it at the moment. But I think we will have like a platform of information and associated members or something like that.
And I think the American institution are also kind of, you know, kind of watching very carefully and also, you know, potentially being very active in this whole, you know, repatriation business. I think, you know, it is very welcome and healthy, and we have just started with very little steps. But I think going forward, there's obviously going to be much more participation because the number of institutions within the U.S. that are aware of what is happening are actually, you know, to a large extent showing interest that they want to be part of what is going on.
So I only have time for one more. Yeah, for sure. There is a question in the back.
Thanks. Tom Seligman, a former African curator here. If I'm correct, in one of Andy's slides, you showed the area of Benin City. You also showed on the other slide, didn't comment on the Brass Casting Guild, which is still, if I'm correct, part of the vibrant culture that is existing in that in Benin City, and related to the Oba and the court of the Oba, at least a section of the guild is. The singular case of Benin, I think, is a very good example of what could go forward, because you have a lineage of Obas that was interrupted by the punitive expedition. You have an Oba, an extremely well-educated man. You have a court that is functioning. You have a history that is remaining. You have a guild that is remaining. You have the artisans that produce the material who can learn from the material. It would seem to me that there are ways, I believe, to avoid the National Museum contexts. They may be ways that still have the paths that still have to be formed, but it would seem to me in this particular case it would be very coherent to return to Benin those objects that would enrich the court of Benin and would enrich the culture of Benin City, enrich the guilds, etc., and future generations. They're not gone. I think Anthony's comment about other cultural artifacts that have come, many of those cultures are so substantially changed that they're a very different context than the context of Benin, I believe.
Yeah, sorry. I put up that slide about the you know Guild of Brass Casters in Goon Street. I don't know why that slide come up there, but you know that is an indication to you know kind of shows that to show like a little landscape of you know Benin City, showing that it's actually thriving. And very correctly, many of the material that we're talking about a living culture, not a culture that is kind of like kind of withered down or disappeared. So yeah, the case of Benin stands out, and I strongly believe that when it eventually comes to the actual repatriation, I have a feeling that all will come back to Benin, because that is obviously where it belongs, and that is where it makes sense for people to you know kind of assess them. I'm sure that even though that the dialogue group comes through the you know top in the bureaucratic ladder, they still come down to Benin and you know kind of do the very very detailed kind of arrangements. I'm thinking that way. Probably Barbara has to explain as much on that if it's different.
Thank you.
guess since there are members that are from Benin City, from various entities, I mean, this is a clear connection, and it's an important connection. And also this vision of this museum will be very relevant for the bronze casters locally, because it puts them, once again, much more clearly in this tradition and the grandeur of this history.
Thank you. I think we could probably continue, and nothing is obviously entirely resolved, so maybe there's a part B to this conversation and a part C. But I thank you all for being here, for your questions, for your attention, and I look forward to the next opportunity. So thank you. Thank you.